And so, anyway, God bless you. Jeremiah chapter 18 in the Old Testament. And this is a passage of scripture that is an illustration for Jeremiah. God told him to go down to the potter's house, and there he would receive a message from the Lord. I believe tonight with all of my life that the greatest need in the life of the church, the greatest need in the life of believers and Christ followers, is the need for us to be broken over our sin, over our world. We need to be broken over some of the apathy that is ours. We need to own it, that we are just not quite as busy for the Lord, I think, as maybe we could be. We could be doing more for Him. And sometimes we even mistake busyness for what He requires. But serving Him and honoring Him with your life is something that is a good thing, that He is not going to reject you if you want to serve Him and you want to honor Him with your life, especially when it comes to telling others about Jesus. And I, by the way, I love these kids down here, so y'all don't worry about them. They're fine with me. They're not going to eat me, okay? But I might nibble on them just a little bit. So we've got 12 grandchildren. I think we mentioned yesterday, 11 of them are boys and one little girl right there in the middle. And so if you got a bunch of girls that you'd like to maybe meet some really godly young men, we can talk after the service and we could write up a contract right quick. And there's some good looking boys. And hey, by the way, Pastor, I got to tell you, you have got to be the twin brother of a friend of mine, Danny Forsey, who pastors where my son is executive pastor in Austin, Texas. I mean, do you have an older brother named Danny by chance? I mean, you two guys, am I not telling the truth? You look just like him. And sitting and talking with you, having a meal with you, I'm just like, that's Danny right there, sitting right there. And he is going with me to Macedonia in a couple of weeks, and he's going to be teaching. We're going to be doing some training. Tomorrow night, I'll talk a little bit more about our ministry overseas. This ministry that you see today is going to go away for a short time. And I'm not going to say that we will not ever do a revival again, but for the time being, for the next few years, our focus is going to be in Eastern Europe. And I will share more about that tomorrow, what that looks like, what God has trusted into our care. And we're grateful for the Lord in this season of life. I'll be 61 this year in August, and I want to use the latter part of my ministry. I feel like I'm in the fourth quarter of my ministry, and I love the fourth quarter of a basketball game. I love the fourth quarter of a football game. I like the last inning of a baseball game. I would rather get right to the business of let's win or lose. Let's get it on right now. And so I feel like maybe I'm in the last quarter of my ministry, and in 42 years of marriage and ministry, been in ministry since day one, I'm thankful for where we've been, but I wouldn't go back and do it again. I'm thankful for what God has done and where He's led us, because He's prepared us for such a time as this, to be here with you. Amen. And I'm thankful for the roads that brought us here. And I'm thankful for the roads that will take us to Georgia next week and then back to East Texas the following week and then overseas for nearly a month. And I'm grateful for that. Again, in August and September, Debbie and I will be over there for eight and a half weeks. And you know what? If you want to come go with us, you just contact me. I will show you how you can go to Eastern Europe, and I'll get you over there. And you say, well, what do I have to offer? Well, number one, you love Jesus. If you love Jesus and you're an English speaker, there's much for you to do over there. And they love people. I have to tell you this. They love Texans. They do. They love Texans. Now, that's not an indictment against you. I have a brother that goes over there with me, a pastor friend from Wyoming. Everywhere we went, the people say, where are y'all from? They don't say y'all. I say, where are you from? And I would say, I'm from Texas. They're like, wow, Texas. Wow. All the way from Texas, yeah. They're like, John Wayne, cowboy. Pow, pow. Do you have a horse? Do you have a gun? You know, they want to know all that. And then they would ask my friend, where are you from? And he'd say, I'm from Wyoming. And they're like, oh. And then they would turn and say, tell me about Texas. And he's like, really? I mean, everywhere we went. And so he just said, I can't believe that. I'm always getting slighted because I'm not from Texas. I'm from Wyoming. And so we were in one city. We were took him to a favorite location where they make paper. And they've got a Gutenberg press knockoff. And they print on that paper. Absolutely amazing. They put scripture on there. Beautiful place. And we're talking to the shop owner. I've been there many times, taking people there. And a big, tall, good-looking kid from Serbia was in there, and his girlfriend was with. They were in there, And he said, you guys are from America. And I said, yes. He said, you're Christ followers. I said, yes, we are. He said, I'm a new believer. And he said, I'm a Baptist by choice. I'm a Christian by conviction, but I'm a Baptist. And I said, well, we're Baptists too. He said, that's incredible. I'd like to know more about what you're doing. Can you kind of communicate with me? I'm always hungry to know more. And so I said, absolutely. And Don got to talk to him. I got to talk into the shop owner for a moment. And I heard him ask Don, where are you guys from? And Don said, well, I'm from Texas. And he said, wow, really, Texas? And he goes, yeah. And he goes, where's your friend from? And he goes, well, he's from Wyoming. He goes, oh. And Don goes, really? Do you know where Wyoming's at? And now he's like, do you know where? He goes, I could probably find it on the card. He meant the map, you know. I could probably find it on the card. I don't know. But Texas. And he's like, wow. And he says, tell me about Texas. I'm hearing all this. Tell me about Texas. And I turned and I said, hey, yeah, Don, why don't you tell us about Texas? And Don says, I'm not from Texas. I'm from Wyoming. He's from Texas. The guy turns his back on Don, looks at him and goes, man, tell me about Texas. So I can't help it. It's just what it is. I'm sorry. You Hawk fans, I'm sorry. It's just the way it is. But I'm thankful that we're cousins. Amen? Amen. And so,
come on. Brother, they just haven't heard the Hawk call yet.
They haven't. The ones from Texas?
Oh, the ones from Macedonia hadn't heard the Hawk call yet.
Oh, you're scared of them slapped to death there, brother. But now, we have a lot of hogs in a row over there, I tell you now. So, y'all just need to come go with us. Come with your pastor. Come over there. We'll have an incredible time sharing Jesus. And we do it in a very relaxed way, but a very good way. They're interested in speaking English. The kids over there, they want to speak English. They want to show us how good they speak English. And it's so cool to be able to witness to them. So we just need your prayers. We'll talk about that some tomorrow night. Tonight I want to share some scripture and illustration that I want to draw for you. And then we're going to let these kids go home and let y'all go home so you'll be back tomorrow night. If you brought a guest, you need to tell Debbie after the service. She's keeping a record there. And on Wednesday night, we're going to give these chalk drawings away to whoever brings the most. So in Jeremiah is told to go down to the potter's house. There he will hear a message from the Lord. Do y'all know what a potter's house, what he means when he says potter's house? Now, the potter's house is where a master craftsman is working. He's making pottery, kind of like something like this. And he's sitting at a wheel on a table, and the wheel is spinning. And the old time pottery, if you go up to Silver Dollar City or some of those places, you can see a potter at work. Maybe you've been up there and you've seen some of that. And there would be a large stone under the table, and they literally move it with their knee, and the stone turns, and it's attached to some wheels and some pieces of leather. And the inertia of that stone turning makes that wheel turn at a pretty good RPM, and the clay is on top of that wheel, and he has got his hands on the clay making a vessel, kind of like this little stand right here, making a vessel, a pot or a bowl or a cup. He's making a vessel at the wheel. Do you understand what I'm saying? Y'all get enough TV, you understand what I mean, amen? So don't make me repeat that. So a potter working at the wheel. And he says he went to the potter's house. He did what the Lord said. And there he was, the potter, was making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. I want you to notice that the scripture doesn't say that the potter is marring the clay with his hands. It says that the clay itself is marred in the hands of the potter. It literally is referencing the fact that the clay has a problem. The clay has got something wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with the master craftsman. He has done this many times. He knows his job. But maybe the clay is too wet, or maybe it's got rocks in it, or it's too dry. It's not submitting to the hand of the potter, and it says that it is marred in the hand of the potter. So he makes it again into another vessel as it seemed good to the potter to make. Look at me just for a moment. Let me catch your attention on this. The Bible says that the potter had intentions for the clay. He was making a vessel as seemed good to the potter to make. And then this is a reference to the life of a person. and the Creator God who is making us and shaping us into the life that He wants us to be. May I submit to you, and please understand that God is not as interested in what you want for your life as He is interested in why He created you and why He put you on this earth and why He made you. He has intentions for your life. Did you hear what I said? God has intentions for you. He has something specifically for every single one of us. Not all of us can be a chalk artist. Not all of us can be a pastor. Not all of us can be a technician. But God has specific things in store for all of us, and all the things that we do in life today, if it's moral and ethical, amen, we can do it for the honor and the glory of God and for His kingdom increase. And so we see here that the potter takes the clay off of the wheel and he shapes it into another vessel as seemed best to the potter to make. So who's in charge, the clay or the potter? Say it loud. The potter is in charge. And so he's going to make this vessel. And when he's got it off of the wheel, think about this. He puts this piece of dirt and water, this clay, on the table. And he is pounding on it with his fist. And he's ripping apart with his hands. He's pressing in on it. He's pouring water on it. He's adding clay to it. He's taking rocks out of it. He is working the clay with his hands. Now, I want y'all to put on your imagination. Everybody look right here just a minute. Put on your imagination. If the clay could speak, I mean, if we can make a mouse speak in a cartoon, if we can make other inanimate objects speak in cartoons, you've got an imagination. If the clay could speak, think about what's happening. It's being knuckled in on, it's being pounded on, it's being ripped apart, it's being rolled out, it's being pressed together, it's been pulled apart. If the clay could speak on the back rows back there, what would the clay say? Yeah. You know, the first real church answer is, oh, mold me and make me. I don't think so. That's not what the clay would say. If you're being pounded on and knuckled in on and pulled apart and ripped apart and pressed back together, the first thing that you're going to say, if you were that clay, you're going to say, stop, ow, why are you doing this? That hurts. You know, a lot of people say today that we as Christians should not question God. I differ from that. Now, if we question God in an act of doubt that God can't do something or won't do something, that is borderline sin. But if we question God enough to say, God, what are you doing? Why are you doing this in my life? What are you about? What are you trying to accomplish in me? What do you want to do? Why are you doing it this way? I believe you are one step closer to getting a good answer from God. Amen? He is not going to leave you doubting. He is not going to leave you wondering. He is not going to leave you worrying. He is not going to leave you without knowledge that He is at work in your life. God is going to answer your question of why and what God is up to. And so I want everybody just to focus on me. Everybody look right here. All you adults. I'm not worried about these guys. Some of y'all staring at them. I want you to look at me just for a moment. These guys don't bother me. Please understand. They are fine. Everybody say, they're fine. All right, I love them. I'm glad they're right there. That's where they need to be. I want everybody else looking at me. Everybody. Don't worry about them. Look at me. This is important for the church. You're going to miss this if you get distracted. Look at me. If the clay is in the hand of the potter being pressed out on the table, put back on the table, the Bible says He makes it into another vessel as seems best to the potter to make. Sometimes it takes your life coming off of the wheel, being put on the table, and pressed out, and pushed on, and pulled on, to be made into the vessel of honor that God wants you to be. And that's not always funny. Amen? It's not always fun. Going through a struggle, or a trial, or a testing time, or a learning time, especially when it includes the hand of God on your life. Hey, know this, the clay always feels the pressure from the potter's hands. And if you're a child of God, and He's got His hands on your life, you will always feel the pressure from the master craftsman's hands. Sometimes it's not funny. The Bible says He chastises those that He loves. If God is chastising you, or God is testing you, or God is putting His hands on you, just understand He loves you. You're His child. You're not an illegitimate child. You're His child. He has adopted you. And He loves you. He created you for a purpose. several years ago, I got a phone call. We were in Arkansas, actually, when this happened. And got a phone call from my uncle that, and my parents, from my parents, that my aunt had passed away. It seemed like the day that she passed away, she and my uncle were just a few days away from being married 50 years. And every morning they would walk outside of their house in Fort Worth along Airport Freeway on the frontage road. And this particular morning they got up, they put their tennis shoes on, they began to walk. And as they walked, she decided on that day she wanted to walk on the outside, not on the curbside, because rocks had been getting in her shoes, and so they swapped. And they're holding hands going down the road, and two boys were towing a vehicle, one with another. One is driving one is in the other one, you know, that's being pulled. And for some reason, one of them in the lead vehicle got distracted, and he turned to look at his friend in the back vehicle. And when he did, he veered off the road, and he brushed my aunt right on the side of the body with his vehicle. And the second one wanted to know what was going on, so he turned his vehicle to see what was going on, and he took my aunt right out of my uncle's arms. She is beautiful. They love Jesus. He was a deacon in the church. She was that aunt that every time I saw her, and Debbie met her, knew her, every time I saw her, I thought, she's the most beautiful silver-haired woman I've ever seen in my life. You know what I ask God? God, why'd you do that? I could have thought of a better way to take her. Come on, y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you? We've all been touched with something like that. God, what are you doing? Why are you doing it like this? And in truth, he doesn't have to explain it to us. He's the craftsman. He's at work. It's all for our good and for his glory, even though it may be tragic and difficult to go through. And we've all been there. I've been through it in our life with other tragedies, and it's not a fun time. God's not being mean. He is not. He doesn't view life and death like you and I do. Why? He is life and he is death. Amen. But he's the giver of life, eternal life. He is the one that sustains us while we live, and he literally takes us to be with him in his presence for eternity, which is literally an amassed time compared to the little bit of time we get to spend on this spinning earth. God has a purpose. And it may not always fit my narrative or my purpose, but God has a purpose. Amen. We see tragedy after tragedy in the scripture, and all the while God is bringing his people to himself. So I don't know what you're going through. It could be marital issues. It could be physical problems. It could be something going on inside of your body that the doctors don't know about and they're trying to figure it out. And you're concerned. Of course you would be. I would be. Maybe you're coming out of a trial. Listen, you're either coming out of a trial or you're heading into one. That's just the way it is. That's life. Because this is not the Garden of Eden. Somebody say amen. Amen. It's just not. And yet, don't we want it to be? Don't we want the politics to just be right? Yeah. Like I like them. Yeah. Right? Don't we want everybody to just be right like I want them to be? My standard. This is not the Garden of Eden. We're trying to recreate that, but guess what? We live in a broken world. We live in a dying world. We've been in that brokenness ourselves. If you're a child of God, you've been saved from brokenness, but you still live in a broken world. And every once in a while, Satan whispers to you and reminds you of your sin and your brokenness. And every once in a while, we kind of have a leaning and a propensity to go do some of the old stuff. Because it's in our heart, it's in our life, and we're just a few days old, the Bible says, and we're full of trouble. So the potter has his hands on us. Be thankful today. Listen to me. Be thankful if the potter's got his hands on your life. So that means you're his vessel. Amen. And he will work it out. He has intentions. So it says here, the word of the Lord came to me, and he said, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, says the Lord? Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. Or are they not experiencing that, God's hand, in the house of Israel today? The instant I speak concerning a nation or concerning a kingdom, to pluck it up, to pull it down, or to destroy it, if that nation against whom I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent. That means have a change of heart. I will relent of the disaster that I thought to bring upon it. And in the instant that I speak concerning a nation or concerning a kingdom, And yes, America's wrapped up in this just as much as anybody else. If God speaks about a nation or about a kingdom to build it up and to plant it, and if it does evil in my sight so that it does not obey my voice, then I will have a change of heart. I will relent concerning the good which I have intended to do and to benefit them with. And so listen, very clear. Very clear. He's in charge and you're not. Amen. He's in charge and I'm not. He's in charge and our government is not. Did you know God's not American? Did you know that? I said that one time, an old boy would take me out back and whip me right there in that church. He was so mad, his face got red. He gritted his teeth. He was so mad. I mean, literally, he had Trump socks on. He had on red, white, and blue. And listen, I know what we need, but we may have what we deserve in our nation today. And I'm an American. I'm a flag waving American. I'm a patriot. And it's getting more difficult every day to be a patriot. In a country that's lost and wicked. I think about people that paid a price for the freedom of this country. How they must feel when they see our country being sold for little of nothing. To nobody. For what reason? God's not an American. You know why? He's bigger than that. Amen? He doesn't get all excited when the flag is waved. Doesn't stand at attention. And I do. I do. I spend a lot of time out of this country. Right at 3 months of the year. And believe me, when I come home, I'm so glad to be on American soil. Even in the condition we're in. And I land in Houston, Texas a lot. That's not the best place in the world. But there's been several times I've wanted to get down and kiss the dirt in Houston, Texas. Crazy as it is. I'm a Fort Worth boy. Well, I'm a Texas Ranger, not a Houston Astro, man. I'm done. I love my country. I love what God is doing in my life and freedom. And the people in other countries say the one thing we see about your country is you have overwhelming freedom. You're blessed beyond measure. And here we are. Freedoms are being threatened every day. Don't you think for a moment that God will chastise a nation like he promised here. He didn't just say this about Israel. He said a nation or a kingdom. If they do not repent, if they do not turn from their sin, then I will relent and have a change of heart of the blessing that I was going to give to them. And America is quickly going in that direction. May his church be steadfast. Somebody say amen. May the church be steadfast. May we stand on God's word and God's promises. May this be where our hope is found. It's found in Christ, in Christ alone, not in our economy, not in our government, not in our education, not in our relationships. It's found in Christ and Christ alone. But there's one thing that stands between us and all of that, and that is sin. It's sin. It is. And I've already mentioned yesterday, sin is against God. I want to ask you tonight to consider something. Is there something in your life that you could give up? You could come clean from so you could get just a little bit closer to God? Is it a relationship? Is it something that you have coveted, that you have held to as most important in your life, and sometimes you even find yourself putting more importance in that thing than on the Lord? Is it somebody? Is there something in your life that is keeping you from being the vessel that God intends for you to be? In no way is he going to put you in front of the public broken and marred in sin and say, I did that and I'm proud of it. Instead, he wants to cleanse us. Amen? He wants to make us into a vessel of honor. So he can put us in front of a broken world and say, I can do the same thing with anyone. If this old boy right here can come to me and have hope and life, then you too can know me. You too can have a relationship with me. I will forgive you of your sin. I will restore and make you into the vessel that I created you to be long before you ever even heard about me. So Christians, what I want to ask you for a moment before we leave here tonight, you're going to see a picture that's going to be a little bit different for you tonight. And I'm going to show you the magic behind the chalk. So I got a lot of chalk going to do in the next few minutes. I want you to watch close. Please just focus and listen. And I pray tonight that this would be the night in your life that you could look back and say, I remember a night in my life when the spirit of brokenness began to overwhelm me. And God began to draw me back to himself in right relationship with him. In a few moments, we're going to have a time of prayer and invitation. So if we can have the lights, please, brother.
Even when I don't deserve it. For- right. Maybe I'll forget. I think that when we get to heaven, we're gonna laugh when we can see how hard we tried to make it.
Sinner, you sin.
We live in a broken world. This brokenness that brings us to this house tonight. I'm thankful Jesus said he came for the broken and the sick. When he's accused of eating with sinners and spending his time with sinners, he came for the lost. He came for the broken. He came for the hurting. If he came for the religious, there was really no reason for him to die. There was really no reason for him to raise from the dead. He came for the broken and the lonely and the wicked and the sinner like you and like me. Amen? And even the religious, they were broken and didn't know it. I'm thankful that even though my life has the scars of my past, and yes, even the scars that my future will have, you see, you aren't done sinning, and neither am I. That's the sad thing. That is the truth and the reality. Broken people, we do broken things. I'm thankful for a Savior that loved me beyond my brokenness. Amen? And gave his life, and he went to a cross. He suffered, and he bled, and he died there to restore me in the creation that he intended me to be all along. A vessel of honor. Even though I have the scars of brokenness, I can still be a vessel of honor. I believe tonight in this room that there are some people that it's been a long time since you've been broken before the Lord. Broken over your sin. Broken over not being obedient to the Lord when he's asked you to step out in faith and follow and do what he asked you to do. Broken in selfishness. My time is important and I'm going to do my time, and God, I will do your time when I can. But one thing that is missing most in the church today is a spirit of brokenness. David said that he was broken over his sins, Psalm 51. He feared one thing. He feared disqualification when it came to being the man that God had called him out to be, and that was the king over God's people. He had been caught in sin, adultery, he committed murder. He was a sinner, but he was a man after the very heart of God. And David didn't admit his sin just because he got caught. He admitted his sin because he knew it was against God. And he grieved over his sin, and he cried out for a cleansing. He cried out for a washing and a purging. You read those verses there in Psalm 51. He said, against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Then he began to pray, God, restore to me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with a free spirit. He said once he had been restored, he could teach sinners the Lord's way. And sinners would be converted. Listen, if you want people to come to Jesus, you come clean. You get right before God. You want your grandchildren and children to come to Jesus, or your husband or your wife or your friend, you come clean before God. And watch what God does with your life to show as an example of them that I can save them, I can save you, I can change you. Here's the one thing that I want to say that David said in the 51st Psalm. Very important. Do not cast me from your presence, O Lord, or take your Holy Spirit from me. He was not talking about being lost again. He was not talking about losing salvation. But he was talking about disqualification. He had seen it in the life of King Saul before him. Who God put an anointing on King Saul, but he withdrew it the very day that Saul sinned against God, willfully turned his back against God and his timing, and God pulled the anointing of being king off of him and put it on David, the little shepherd boy. David saw King Saul all through those latter years of his life in his depression. Until one day, the scripture says, Saul fell on his own sword and ended his life. And now here is David caught in sin, adultery, and murder. And he said, do not cast me from your presence, O God. Do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Listen, folks, if you really believe there was a danger of you being disqualified when it comes to serving God and honoring God with your life, we might run back to him and say, God, forgive me. I've wandered away from you. And now I'm coming back home to you. Restore me. Refresh me. That's what revival looks like. I want to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes. In just a moment, we're going to get in our cars and vehicles and go home. But our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Our pastor is going to turn on a few lights. He's going to be waiting here at the front of the room. The pastor, there's a microphone there for you in a few moments when it's time for you to share what God puts on your heart. But I want to ask you, please, everyone, bow your head and close your eyes. I want you to think of no one else in this room but the person sitting in your skin. Everyone else will take care of themselves. Draw a circle around you. God, talk to him. Am I the vessel of honor that you want me to be? Don't pray for your neighbor. There'll be time for that later. God, am I the vessel of honor that you want me to be? And am I the one that you called out? Am I fulfilling what you asked me to do with joy, with contentment? Realizing that you have more ahead for me to do than ever before to honor your kingdom and see your kingdom grow. That's where I want to find my joy.